God is good all the time. Song number 12. God is good all the time. Pour a song of praise in his heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkness night, his light will shine. God is good, God is good all the time. If you're walking, if you're walking through the valleys, there are shadows all around. Do not fear, he will guide you, he will keep you safe and sound. He has promised never to leave you nor forsake you, and his word is true. God is good all the time. Before a song of praise in his heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkness night, his light will shine. God is good, God is good all the time. We are sinners, unworthy, but still he chose for us, and he died on the cross for you and me. We are sinners, so unworthy, still for us he chose to die. Fill us with his Holy Spirit, now we can stand and testify that his love is everlasting, and his mercies they will never end. God is good, God is good all the time. The pour a song of praise in his heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkness night, his light will shine. God is good all the time. Understand all the plans you have for me. My life is in your hands, and through the eyes of faith I can clearly see. God is good all the time. Before a song of praise in his heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkness night, his light will shine. God is good all the time. He is so good all the time. God is good all the time. Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
man shall not live by the bread alone, but from the every word which comes out of the mouth of God.
Man shall not live by bread alone, it's from the mouth of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Sing to the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Shall be given unto you. Seek, ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be open unto you. Hallelujah.
Ask, and it shall be given unto you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be open unto you. Hallelujah.
Sing to the Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Praise to the Lord. Here we go.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that men desire. Adore you, hope of our life spent with you.
That's why.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
King of all days, you are solely highly exalted, glorious in heaven above.
King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake began born. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
We cannot understand the Lord's love, the price He paid on the cross.
sin upon that cross. I never knew how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross.
Together.
I never knew how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
You are wonderful to be praised. Heavenly Father, we praise your name. Almighty God, we praise your name. God of Jacob, we praise your name. God of hosts, we praise your name. Elohim, Lord, we praise your name. What are you talking?
Every breath that I take, I praise you. With every move that I make, with everything that I am, I'll praise you, 'cause there is no other way. We stand together with heart joined as one. We give you glory for all you have done. Everybody get up, you love him. Everybody get up and praise him. Everybody get up, you free and give him the praise. With every breath that I take, I'll praise you. With every move that I make, with everything that I am, I'll praise you, 'cause there is no other way. We stand together with hearts joined as one. We'll give you glory for all you have done. Everybody get up, if you love him. Everybody get up and praise him. Everybody get up, if you're free and give him the praise. You, everything is all for you, you. Living is safe for you, you. Everything is all for you, you.
It is for you, Lord.
You, you. Everything is all for you, you. Living is safe for you, you. Everything is all for you, you.
One more time.
You, you, everything is all for you, you. Living is safe for you, you. Everything is all for you, you. Everybody get up, you love him. Everybody get up and praise him. Everybody get up, you free him, give him the praise. Everybody get up, you love him. Everybody get up and praise him. Everybody get up, you free him, give him the praise.
Everyone on earth, you hold it is you.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. God of grace, we come with all we have, bodies, souls, minds, all here to worship you. We have come for a glimpse of your kingdom of kindness, a world where love rules over all, a world where enemies embrace, distinctions between friend and foe evaporating in the light of your love. We dedicate this hour of worship to you and to your kingdom come. Amen. The scripture portion selected for this evening's meditation is taken from the Gospel according to St. John, first chapter, beginning from 9 to 18, and the epistle lesson is taken from the Epistle to Ephesians, first chapter, 10th verse. I request Ms. Bharati to read the portion for us.
Today's scripture portion taken from the Gospel according to John, chapter 1, verses 8 to 18. He was not that light, but was sent to be a witness of that light. That was the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, he who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him." And Ephesians chapter 1, verse 10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of the times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in Him. Amen. Thank you.
Let's look forward, thanking God for all the good things He has done to us and hoping for better and wonderful things in the time to come. Let us bow down our heads and look to the Lord in prayer. O God, our Lord, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, we thank you and praise you for the time. We thank you, O Lord, for bringing us this evening to thy tabernacle to spend time at thy feet in thy presence. We praise you, O God, for the past year. You are with us, guiding us, helping us, leading us. Now as we come to thy presence, O Lord, on the very first Sunday of the new year, we praise you and we look to you, O God, to lead us in the days to come. We thank you and praise you for the peace you have given us, O Lord. Thy peace. At this time we pray for the peace in the world. Many parts of the world are disturbed, O Lord. We pray for thy peace in these places. We pray for the leaders of our country, O Lord. Give them wisdom to lead this country in the proper way. We pray for the leaders of our state. O Lord, at this time, we pray for the church in our country. We pray for all the pastors, evangelists, and all the people that are involved in thy work, and all the organizations that are run in thy name, preaching thy gospel, showing thy love to the people around us, O Lord. O Lord, we come to thy presence, seeking thy guidance for each and every family of this congregation. We pray for the elderly people of this congregation, O Lord. Give them peace of mind, health and strength. We pray for the infants of this congregation. Give the parents wisdom to bring them up through in thy word, in thy ways. We pray for the youngsters of this congregation, O Lord, as they are studying and working, staying in different places, in different towns, in different countries. We pray for them specially. Keep away them from the evil one. Protect these youngsters, O Lord, as they are away from their parents. O Lord, we pray for all the congregations of Nellore town, our pastors, our evangelists. We thank you and praise you, O Lord, for the time you have given us, witnessing unto thee the time of Christmas. Strengthen the church in our town, O Lord. We pray for all the organizations like the Mission for the Blind, the Friends Prayer Missionary Band, the Indian Evangelical Mission, the Gideon's International. As these people are spreading thy gospel, showing their love to the people, O God, bless them, strengthen them, fill in their needs. If there is anyone here, O Lord, with a special need, we pray for them. If there is anyone sitting here with a temptation, O Lord, guide them, lead them through the temptation, strengthen them, O Lord. If there is anyone sick and needy, touch them and heal them, protect them, O Lord. This evening, as we meditate over thy word, O Lord, speak to us through thy word. Let thy spirit speak and touch everyone that is sitting here, O Lord. We pray for all the members that are sitting here this evening. We praise you, O Lord, for the time you have given them to bring them to thy presence. We thank you and praise you for the choir as they are singing praise unto thee. O Lord, bless them and lead them. We commit ourselves into thy hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As human, we promise many people in many occasions. That promise may be fulfilled or may not be fulfilled, but the promise given by God always will be there with us. Those who ever follow His words, definitely God will give us His eternal kingdom. That's what the song is about, standing on the promises. This was written by Kelso Carter in the period between 1849 to 1928. The lyrics of the song says like this: standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God.
Shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. On the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord. Overwhelming daily with the Spirit's word, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fail, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Good evening. And we welcome you all to this evening's worship service. If there is anyone sitting here for coming for the very first time, please make it your place of worship as long as you are in Nellore town. We commence our sing song at 6:30 p.m. and close our worship by 8 o'clock. And I recognize Dr. Devaraj Zulagaru and then Dr. Beatty with us, and also Dr. Praveen, and Mrs. Dr. Praveen is there. And I also see some of our choir members, new one, they have come back. So I welcome you all to this evening's worship service. I also thank Ms. Bharati for reading the scripture portion for us. And I thank Yashwant and Sunrat for being the ushers today. Choir practice will be on Friday evening at 7 p.m. as usual. Let all glory and honor be unto the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dearly beloved in Christ Jesus, I thank our Downie Hall Committee for giving me this privilege of sharing the Word of God this evening, and praise God for this wonderful privilege and the time given to me. The scripture portion taken for this evening's meditation is taken from the Gospel account of St. John, 1st chapter 8 to 18, and also the Epistle of Ephesians, 1st chapter 10th verse. These are the portions, when we look into it, how wonderfully they coincide with each other. They tell us of the truth of the Word of God. That is, we see that when we come to this Gospel according to John, here we are seeing that John speaks of the Word of God becoming the flesh, becoming flesh. He says that incarnation. He says that the Word, the living Word, the eternal Word, the Word which is God, he says that has become flesh. That's wonderful thing he is using here. And he goes on to say that this is the manifestation, the final manifestation we are seeing, that God in his own time, he was speaking to the humanity in different ways. So we see that St. Paul speaking to the Ephesians, 1st chapter 10th verse, where he was telling us that God in his own, he uses the word dispensation. That means it is the final dispensation, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. So here we are seeing that John specifically tells us how the Word of God became incarnate, while Paul refers to all the dispensations. And here we see that God was speaking to humanity from time to time in his own way with a special revelation. a specific revelation. He was giving certain thing, he was expecting obedience. So we can say that these are dispensations, or we can say sort of regimens, we can say that. So there are seven regimens, or rather dispensations, given in our Bible. One is the first dispensation of innocence, the Adamic period. But when Adam has fallen, we see that he lost fellowship with God, and a chasm has developed between the holy God and the sinful man. Thus the fellowship was lost. But God did not leave Adam at that. God is kind, God is merciful. So he had a plan of his own to bring back the fallen man back again into his fellowship. So this is what we are seeing in Adamic time. Then comes the second period, Genesis 3:7. This period, rather, this dispensation is said to be conscience or moral responsibility. That means God has given the sense to man to feel which is right and wrong, because already Adam has eaten of the fruit and he knew what is right and wrong. And God has put his mind in Adam, and people knew which is good or bad. So this is what we call the conscience or moral responsibility dispensation. So thus we see that then, because it is said, and the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew they were naked, it is said that. So this is the second dispensation. Coming to the third dispensation, that's called the Noahic dispensation. It is the human government, Genesis 8:15, where God speaks to Noah and asks him to go forth out and then replenish the earth. So he puts him responsible for the entire earth and asks him to replenish the entire world. Then we come to the Abrahamic period, that is Genesis 12:1, where God calls Abraham, and Lord said unto Abraham, go to the land I will show you. So this is the Abrahamic dispensation we are seeing. Then we come to the dispensation of the law, the fifth one, which is in Exodus 9:1. We see that Moses is called by God, and God asks Moses to bring his people back out of Egypt and puts him in charge of that redemption. So he asks Moses to go to Pharaoh and tell him that send my people so that they can come and worship me. So this is the Mosaic period of law. Later we know that after coming to Sinai, they were given the Ten Commandments. So that's the period we are seeing. Then we come to, later we come to the coming of the Lord. This is the period we are discussing. That is, after the coming of the Lord, after his redemptive act on the cross, we are seeing that, then as he has promised, on this rock I'll build my church. So on that faith of Peter, the church is built, and as these disciples, as well as the 120 people around them, other disciples, as they were sitting in the upper room, as they were praying with of one mind, one accord, then we see that the miracle happened, that the Holy Spirit descended on these people and then strengthened them. It gave them power. So these people who were covering themselves, hiding themselves in the upper room, once they were filled with the Holy Spirit, they were different people. They came out into public, then they said, you are the people who have killed the Prince of Peace. And then it is said that on that day, 3,000 people were added to the church. And then the final one will be coming, that is the kingdom eternal. In Revelation 24, we see that, and I saw thrones and reigning with people. Other people will be there on the thrones, and there will be 1,000 years rule will be there. That is the final eternal kingdom to come. For that kingdom we are waiting. For that kingdom we are looking forward with the hope and with the courage to say that those that have believed in the Lord, those that are in the Lord, are confident that when he comes, they'll be there in the group that will be lifted up. So now, coming back to John, we are seeing that John is telling us that while others were describing that it is, while Matthew was telling that Jesus is son of Abraham, and then Luke was telling us that it is son of Mary and Joseph, and the times, historical account, that in the time of Augustus Caesar, Quirinius, Herod and all that. Now here we come to this, the fourth evangelist, who gives and looks at the birth of Jesus in a different angle. Because by this time, many outsiders, non-Jews, have come into the church. To them, he is introducing the Christ, a Christ who is eternal, a Christ who is not just born, a Christ who is not of Abraham, but he is introducing a Christ who is from the beginning, who is Alpha and Omega. So this is what we are seeing. John the Baptist has a different angle of explanation. So here we are seeing that he said that was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. So when God was present in the world, speaking to the people, they could not understand him. He came to his own people through prophets. They did not receive him. And then it is said that, but as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Those people that believe in Jesus are empowered to become sons of God. So here we are shown that he is the fullness. In 16th verse it is said that, and of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. So this incarnation, rather this word, this Savior who became human being. So this is what in 14th verse, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we have beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. God is filled with glory. So that's why John goes back to that and says that, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father. So wherever God is, there is glory. Now this is a reference back to, if we go to Exodus 40th chapter, there we see that the wonderful mention is made, and it's more appropriate for us just to look at that portion and see that how wonderfully God has his plans. That is, in Exodus 40th chapter, we are seeing that the wonderful portion is here. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, on the first day of the first month shalt thou set up the tabernacle of the tent of the congregation. So on the New Year's Day, God asked Moses, instructed Moses to erect the tabernacle. And Moses, after preparing everything, and finally he erected the tabernacle on that special day. When in 33, and he reared up the court round about the tabernacle and the altar, and set up the hanging of the court. So Moses finished the work. 40th chapter 33-34, we see that. Once so Moses finished the work, then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. So we see that wherever God is present, there is his Shekinah, his special, we can see glory. So thus, once the tabernacle was fit and it was erected, it is said that when Moses finished all the work, when he has placed the ark in the Holy of Holies, when he has put the curtain down, and when he has come out, it is said that then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. So this is Shekinah we are seeing. To this glory, John is referring. We have seen his glory. There in the days of Moses, in the tabernacle, when the Shekinah comes onto the mercy seat, covered by the two wings of the cherubs, we see that. No one can go there. Only the high priest can enter there with the blood of a lamb once in a year. He can go there only with once in a year with propitiating blood, the ransom, and goes there to touch it to the altar there. So Shekinah filled that. No one can see it. It is present within the tabernacle. But again, we see that this Shekinah is coming out of the tent, and above the tent we see the cloud. This cloud, like a tree, it is spreading out. And during the daytime, it is giving comfort from the hot sun in the desert. People were given rest. There was shadow for them during the daytime. And during nighttime, the same cloud have become luminous. It was light and warmth was there for the people. So thus the Shekinah was present in the tabernacle. And we see that during the daytime, physically outside, people can see only the cloud. This is the presence of God with his people. God encompassing his people with his protection. So this is the glory, we see that. The same glory we see again when we come to the book of 1 Kings. There we see that in 1 Kings 8 chapter 11th verse, we see King Solomon completes the construction of the temple in Jerusalem. After completing that, there it is said that the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord, and no one could go inside. The priests could not go inside because of the glory of God. So where God is present, there is glory. And twice we are seeing in the Exodus, in the tabernacle, we are seeing his Shekinah, and in the temple of Solomon who built it, there we are seeing that as he has prepared everything, kept everything in its own place, dedicated them for that. After anointing, we see that Shekinah filled the temple of God. Now we come to the third time, the glory of God. That's what John is referring to. So thus, in the history of man, God has his own dispensations in different ways. He was talking to them. He was sending his disciples. He has given his scriptures. He has sent his angels. And finally, as we see, as it is said in Ephesians 1st chapter 10th verse, in the final dispensation, he sent his own begotten son. Galatians 4:4 says that in the fullness of time, he sent his only begotten son. In the fullness of time, God prepared humanity. God prepared history. And then in the fullness of time, during Roman Empire, God sent his only begotten son in the days of Augustus Caesar. So this is what he is referring to, and says that, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So God becoming flesh, imagine that. God created everything, and the Creator is becoming flesh for the sake of man. He condescended to such a level to become flesh. It's beyond our imagination. God, by his love, he could come to such a level to identify with a sinner. He became flesh to know that how man feels. So he lived amongst us as a human being, knowing what is hunger, knowing what is anger, knowing what is sorrow, So that's why he is called the man of sorrows. He has taken our sorrows unto himself. He has taken our sin unto himself. And he paid the wages of sin through his death on the cross. He paid the ransom. He gave the propitiation for our sins. Though we are sinners, unworthy to come near to him. So this love which compelled God to come down to us, speak to us. I read an article wherein it is said that an Indian went to USA. He had a big farm there. And he had love for all the creatures. So one day it seems his entire place was being cleaned by bulldozers. And as he was watching, there was a very big ant hill full of ants. They were very busy collecting their food, going in lines to and fro, bringing the food back and then storing. The bulldozer was coming this way. In a couple of minutes, it will come and take away the ant hill. And all the ants, millions of these ants, will be killed. So this man was standing. He just wanted to warn those ants. How could you do it? How could a man warn the ants? And then he felt, if I am an ant, I could go and tell them that, run. Run away from here, because the bulldozer is coming. And then he says that, this feeling, this experience, gave me the opportunity to understand how God became flesh. Why God became flesh? He wanted to warn man. He wanted to redeem man of his sins. So he became flesh by himself to know that how weak we are. He identified himself with us. He is the glory of God. He is the Shekinah. And this Shekinah came to live in the flesh like a human being. And I read that somewhere that in Hebrew, it is said that God tabernacled himself in flesh. Just as in the case of the old tabernacle of the desert, as in the case of this temple built by Solomon, Shekinah came and entered into the temple. So also Shekinah of God came and entered into flesh. That's the glory of God. So thus we see that Christ, Jesus, the Creator, he tabernacled himself. And another word said is, he tented himself like a tent. He entered into it. It is said, for our sake, he came. And when he came, the words used by John is, full of grace and truth. Full of grace and truth. These are two things which cannot go side by side. Grace is kindness, unmerited, for an unmerited thing, you want to give a gift. Unworthy we are. If someone gives us something, we don't deserve it. Undeserving people getting the best things, that is grace. In the education department, when many people fail, marks are added to certain percentage so that the failing percentage will be brought down and many people are pushed into, we can say, eligible for college study. They have failed, but marks are added to them, grace marks. So unmerited thing is people are getting merit for that. So this is grace. But then truth. If truth is that they have failed. Truth is very strict, stern. So if we take truth, we see that they must fail, they have failed, and they must be put out. But here it is said that two things are coming together, full of grace and truth. This is Jesus. Unworthy we were, not to be counted, cannot come to the presence of God. But out of His love, He called us to His presence and made us call Him Abba, Father. This is the privilege we are given. So thus we see that in Christ we are seeing the grace. This is the incarnate and this is Emmanuel, God with us. He is with us. Flesh, creatures, standing beside, we can say, the Creator. In the olden days, in the desert of Sinai, in the tented village of Israelites, in the midst of that village was the tabernacle. Tabernacle with its all glory. People around it were in a circumference. They were living there. Everyone was equally nearer to the tabernacle. Everyone can see the cloud over the tabernacle. We see that. Everyone could say that, I am neighbor to the tabernacle. And when Jesus came flesh by Himself, He is our neighbor. He is our kinsman because He identified Himself with flesh and became incarnate. So this is what we see, that we can feel Him. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. They can see God. It is not with the physical eye. It's not with the ears. It is with your heart. If only you put your mind, if only you look to Him in prayer, in meditation, you feel the presence of God. And this is what one of our eminent preachers, Paul Sudhakar, he says this. Paul Sudhakar, as you know, was a student of our former ex-president of India, Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. So Paul Sudhakar says that you must feel the presence of Christ. You must feel, not just reading it, not just saying Jesus, not just saying Redeemer. You must feel His presence, Emmanuel. So he calls it as Anubhava. You experience the presence of Christ. So Christ should be, this incarnation should be, for us, it should be an Anubhava. You must feel His presence. So on this first Sunday, we are called to feel, you are called to experience this incarnation, because as we proceed, we see that you ought to be witnesses unto Him. It's not only enjoying the fellowship with the Lord, or knowing Him, or having Him your Redeemer, but you are going to be witnesses unto Him. So we see that grace redeems, it blots out sin, it renews our heart, it regenerates us, pardons and comforts. And coming to truth, as I said earlier, truth is always harsh. You cannot take truth as it is. Because we are sinners. But His truth is, it's not a condemning type of truth, nor punishing truth, nor censuring truth. His truth is steeped in love. His truth is saturated with mercy. Because He substituted Himself for our sake. In our place, He became the substitute. He became our representative of humanity and paid the penalty. He is the fulfillment of all divine promises. He has bruised the serpent's head, borne our griefs and sorrows. He proclaimed liberty to the captives. He is a prophet like Moses. He is the Paschal Lamb of God, the true scapegoat. So thus, dearly beloved, we are given all these privileges because He became incarnate. Glory lived amongst us. Even today, you can feel the glory. You can feel His presence when you sit in prayer, when you spend your own special time with Him. You feel His presence. When you ask Him, when you a special request you put forward, He answers your prayers. When you are troubled, when you are groaning, the Lord comforts. You feel His presence is there. So this Creator, this Word that became flesh is living with us today, and we are asked and given a promise. He said, I'll come again. He said, I'll come again. Go ye to the uttermost part of the world, preaching, making disciples. So, as the redeemed ones, has His own church, purchased with His own precious blood, adopted by Him, as the Word says that, being His children, as it is said here, He has given authority to become His sons and daughters, it is said that. So, God is calling sinners to Himself, and He is giving us authority to be His children. It's a wonderful word, we are seeing that. But as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. He became a man, flesh, and then that God enabled us to become sons of God because He became flesh by Himself. So this is how we see that, God becoming flesh. And today we are blessed with His presence, we are blessed with His promises, because He said that, lo, I am with you always, I will not leave you alone. Whenever we are in problem, troubles, when we stand for Him, He is with us always, strengthening us, filling us with His Spirit and leading us. So as a church, as a family of His children, it is our delightful privilege to have His presence, and also it is our duty to go out and preach the gospel, to be witnesses unto Him until He comes. So as we see that, and to use the words of Saint Paul, we are saying that when Saint Paul says that in his a letter to Corinthians, first Corinthians 16th chapter, in the last 22nd verse, he says that, if any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be anathema, maranatha. So God is giving us time. God is giving people opportunity. The word is spread in all the languages. In 24 hours now, over the TV, you see the word of God is being spread in every language. All nations are hearing the word of God. All prophecies, end time prophecies, are being fulfilled. The time is nearby. So the church should be ready for the rapture. And as Paul has said, used the word, he said that, Maranatha. Maranatha, Lord, come. It's time. We have done our job. So it is to ourselves to question, have I done my job? Have I done the privilege that is given to me, to my family, to my church, to my congregation? Have we done our job? So in closing, we see that He is inviting us. If there is anyone who have not committed yourself to Lord Jesus as His child, here is the opportunity. He is calling, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He is inviting. If you are having a problem with sin, if you have a problem of a temptation at your heart, if you are worried, if you are haunted by evil spirits, there is no direction in your life, come to me. Wonderful invitation we are seeing. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And finally we see Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcome and am set down with my Father in his throne. May the Lord give us the strength. May the Lord give us the opportunity to be witness unto him as we are feeling his glory, his presence in our lives, in our families, in our congregation and society. It is not enough if we keep Christ for ourselves. It is said, the accusation is that Jews kept God for themselves. Yahweh only for themselves, not for others. Have we become that sect again? Christ only for Christians? No. God says that, go ye to the uttermost part and preach the gospel, making disciples of all the people. Let's look to the Lord and pray that he will give us the guidance. Oh God, our Lord, we sit in thy presence. We thank you for the invitation, O Lord. We thank you for becoming flesh by yourself to know the weaknesses of man. We thank you, O Lord, for identifying yourself with us to make us sons of God. Thank you for the privileges. Thank you for the gifts of spirit you have given to the church. Enable us to be witnesses unto thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In closing, let's stand and sing hymn number 295, Just As I Am Without One Flea. Outside, tea and coffee are arranged. I request you, all of you, join in the fellowship sponsored by a senior member of our congregation. I thank him for that. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. O God, our Lord, we come to thy presence. We are weak, but thou art mighty. We were away from you, by thy love you have drawn us towards you, O Lord. You have made us thine own. We praise you, O Lord. As we go out again into the world, be with us and guide us. Fill us with thy spirit. Give us the opportunities to witness unto thee, O Lord. Strengthen every one of us. Use us mightily in the days to come to be instruments of thine, useful in thy vineyard. Winning souls, O Lord, give us this experience. We commit ourselves into thy hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The love of God, the grace of the Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.
Jesus, thank you, Jesus.